sound.
Visible to
them. Right. Go ahead.
So now today's class will be an important one for everyone, because CBD stones have been one among the most common, not only cases for discussion, but remember that CBD stones, the most important understanding is that if you are into general surgery or GI surgery, whatever you do, or your tenure as a general surgeon, throughout your life, you are going to get patients with a gallbladder stone. And while you get a patient with a gallbladder stone, please remember that about 10 to 20%, based on the various data and the various guidelines, our patients are going to have a stone in the bile duct. So when we talk about a stone in the bile duct, remember that before I start the class about and talk about stones in the bile duct, there are a lot of confusions from very, very senior surgeons even across the various tenure of their life. And across today I was having a talk with Rudrajit also, and I was saying him because we once had a candidate who was given a case about a bile duct stone, and he told the examiner that he will like to do a laparoscopic CBD, close the bile duct and give a stent. Well, he is absolutely right. And that was not around 5 or 6 years back. So what he did was absolutely right, and that should have been done. Whereas the examiner was a little on the older side, so, and he was mostly expected, or his unit mostly did an open CBD. So for him, it came to be as a cultural shock, in which he could not understand how can you close the bile duct by just giving a stent. So as you see that these are the problems that you will always encounter, not only in your today's class, but also with your practice. But there will be many if and many but, and there are many what if and what not that are going to come in this whole topic. So what I have done is that before I start with the class, I brought in that the more you are required to read and the more you are asking for evidences, ki sir, what is the basis that which you are having your talk? Remember that I have had two guidelines. This is the 2017 management of bile duct stone guideline. This was published in the GUT and is a very good comprehensive summary about what should have been done. Simultaneously, this is this year's January publication, and remember January or February publication is one among the latest that you can think over that can be on particularly surgeons managing CBD stones. Remember that this was mostly, this is the publication from Surgical Endoscopy, and they support the SAGES guidelines with more or less a very beautiful summary in a question and answer form about what is about these guidelines. So these are the two publications. If you are interested in publications and to know as a postgraduate, what are the things to know about? Now, let us start with the topic now. Now, as I have said, gallbladder stones are one amongst the most common diseases that you will get in your surgical practice. We'll not talk about gallbladder stones today. We are going to talk about a bile duct stone. So gallbladder stones, as you see, are one among the most common, and in our eastern part of India, this definitely disease is much more commoner than other parts of India or the rest of the world. Okay, but still, now gallbladder stones, remember a little recap of your basic MBBS knowledge. If you think over why does the gallbladder stone form, we are not going to learn details and technicalities, but majority of stones in the Western world are cholesterol stones, where the major ingredient, people say that more than about 70 to 80% of the stone should be a cholesterol, and is usually formed when there is a mismatch between the cholesterol that is excreted and things that make cholesterol soluble, that includes phospholipids, lecithins, etc., make the things soluble and can be seen in multiple conditions, starting from diet, drugs, etc., or genetic predisposition. The second type of the stone that probably is more common in the Indian perspective is a mixed variety of stone, where if a cholesterol stone has a shape that looks like a goal, a round spherical shape, whereas a mixed stones usually have a faceted shape. And at the end of this, you will always get a bacteria, and the bacteria will always form at the core. And remember, a mixed stone is called mixed because it contains a big part of cholesterol as well as bile pigments to consider. Now, the next part of this cholesterol and mixed stone, for a surgeon to remember, is that they are not seen on X-rays. So they are technically radiolucent. So please remember that they are technically radiolucent. They are not seen on an X-ray. The last variety of stone is something that we start our CBD stone business with, is something called as a pigment stone. Now, in the gallbladder, there is a confusion that students have. The gallbladder, remember, is known to concentrate. The gallbladder only concentrates. That means, if you think over this chota sananasa organ called as gallbladder, so small. However, the epithelium of the gallbladder is known to be one amongst the most efficient mucosas ever, at least till the time it was normal. And the only job it does is that it absorbs all the water and concentrates the bile. So if there is more bilirubin polymers that are secreted, which are very characteristic of a case of a hemolysis, example, hemolytic anemia. In hemolytic disorders, you get formation of something called as a pigment stone. Now, pigment stones are known to get mixed up with calcium, and people have proposed that maybe that a part of them, about 50%, may be radio opaque. But pigment stones are not that common and are only seen in a hemolytic disorder. So please remember, will only be seen if there is a hemolytic disorder. So what are the three types of gallstones? Before we go to the CBD and take a plunge in the whole evening with a bile duct, cholesterol stone said to be the most common, mixed stone said to be the most common in India, and the last one, made of bilirubin polymers, is something called as a pigment stone, which is usually black in color, and hence people will call this to be more of a black pigment stone. So three types of stones. Gallbladder contains cholesterol. Mixed stones, remember, at the center of a mixed stone lies a bacteria. And the next one is something called as a black pigment stone. You knew about all of this, so nothing that great till now. But what is important gyan that we received till now this point is only one. Majority of gallbladder and stones are radiolucent. They are not going to be picked up by a X-ray. When I say X-ray, you are understanding who the hell does an X-ray for a gallbladder stone. We don't. But guys, with the amount of the CT scan that takes over in the whole body, that means that which is impervious to an X-ray is also not seen on a CT scan. So please do not expect something that has not been picked up will be shown on a CT. So CT is not a good thing for this part. Now, let us talk about the next story. The stone now takes a route, and the stone migrates over to the bile duct. So let us take our journey into the bile duct stones. So whenever we talk about a stone in a bile duct, remember that bile duct stones are grossly divided or classified into two things. One is something called as a secondary bile duct stone. I call this before primary. Secondary because it comes from the gallbladder, and the stone, as you can imagine, the stone comes from the gallbladder and it comes in the bile duct through the way of the cystic duct, mind this point, and will come because you are a surgeon and your surgery has to take this consideration. And this is going to travel down, and in some cases, remember, either the stone passes in the duodenum, lucky for the stone and the patient, or the stone comes here and blocks the terminal part of the bile duct, or the most dangerous of things. The stone comes out here, lodges into a place called as a duodenal. Some people call it as ampullary. Some people say that no, this is different from the term called as a periampullary, because gastroenterologists have various names for them. There is a diverticula. For us as surgeons, the nuisance that it causes is that these stones sometimes comes into this route and is responsible for producing a pancreatitis. So if I ask you now, so what is the fate of a stone then? So the main thing that you are required to know is that the stones are going to come. Majority of the stones will gradually come down and pass into the duodenum. Very lucky. So the patient is very happy. The next thing is that it gets impacted in the distal end. Now, why does it get impacted in the distal end? Simple questions. I told you from basics. Simply because it is very narrow rather than it is very angulated. Some people say that, no, you are not perfectly right. There is also a problem with the sphincter of OD, whose muscles will undergo a bit of spasm, and maybe that is a cause. So that is the first part. So last point, it goes into the peri-CVD diverticula. So that is secondary. Now remember that secondary has to have a gallbladder. The next part then is something called as a primary. If you have a secondary and then you have a primary. Now what is a primary bile duct stone? Now lots of confusions, hence I dug something into history. And I took out this important landmark publication. If you see, the first gentleman's name is Prakash Shaharia. So, and this year of publication is about in late 70s or early 80s. So this gentleman from this John Hopkins Institute gave a criteria called as Shahari's criteria. So let us look at that name again. If you have not looked at the name, Shaharia's criteria. Okay, so Shaharia's criteria, and till to this time, with the definitely dilutions and modifications, Shaharia's criteria has remained as a standard one, at least for surgeons, if not for others. Now, what is this one? It means technically that the stone forms in the bile duct. So what is the primary bile duct stone? Now, primary bile duct stone, we'll talk about Shaharia's criteria, but very straightforward means that it forms into the bile duct. So that means the stone forms in the bile duct. BD is the bile duct. That's it. Now, the first points first. Why will a stone form in the bile duct? How can a stone form in the bile duct with the gallbladder being normal? So the first and the most controversial thing to begin the day with. Please understand one straightforward simple thing. The gentleman by the name, what was the name of the gentleman? Shaharia. He told a very, very straightforward flat thing. One, if you are making into a diagnosis of a primary bile duct stone, he said that the patient must have cholecystectomy, and cholecystectomy has to be greater than 2 years ago. That also means that within 2 years of a cholecystectomy, if you diagnose a patient with a CBD stone, the cause of such a stone is always the gallbladder, whose stone came into the bile duct and you missed that stone. That's it. We'll talk about that later. Now, when you talk about the second criteria, he said that the stone is usually of a pigment in nature. Now, when I talk about pigment, he said that the stone is brown or the stone is soft in nature. Remember that gallbladder stones were not soft. Pigment, particularly black, was not at all soft. So this is brown and soft. Okay. Next one. So he told about these two important criteria. He told about there should also be an absence of a long cystic duct. Now, as a surgeon, you know what is a cystic duct. And as a surgeon, you have done cholecystectomies. Absence of a long cystic duct. And he also told that absence of distal stricture. Okay. So this is what this gentleman told. And for a long time, this criteria is still a good criteria for us surgeons to go by. So if a patient has a stone in the bile duct that is diagnosed more than 2 years, mind it, he said too, though we are coming to what has changed, is this is something called as a Shaharia's criteria. Now, come to what has gradually changed. People over the years understood that probably the thing is not exactly by the way Shaharia described, though I strongly follow the Shaharia's criteria. People said that just imagine a situation where the gallbladder is absolutely normal, but there is a parasite which is there in the bile duct. Like say, for example, Clonorchis, or say, for example, very commonly in India, an Ascaris. And these are responsible for bringing bacteria in the bile. Now, similarly, if you think about bacteria in the bile, if you put a stent in the bile duct for other reasons, say for example, a sphincter of OD problem, etc., and then you forget to take out the stent, it is going to invite the bacteria. Now, when bacteria gets invited, bacteria secrete an enzyme called as glucuronidase. And when it secretes something called glucuronidase, it now converts the glucuronic acid from the bilirubin diglucuronide and leads to formation of bilirubin. Okay. And some amount of calcium also along with glucuronic acid. Now, the bilirubin and the calcium, along with multiple other salts, combine to make a calcium bilirubinate, and it combines with an oleate and a palmitate. At the end of the day, if you are confused, remember, so is the stone. The stone then that forms. The stone that forms is really confused and says that, oh my God, what should I be made up of? And if they are made up of, remember that, they are just like mud. So it is just like mud. Okay? And it is soft. Looks like a sludge. Okay? But definitely remember, at the center of this will lie a bacteria. So if you remember up to this is what we have seen in a clinical practice. So if someone asks you, what is a primary bile duct stone? What is a primary bile duct stone? Please understand that the primary bile duct stone the gallbladder is normal. Empty will not be the word. The gallbladder is normal, but in the presence of parasite infections in the bile duct or due to a stent in the bile duct for any other reason, the stone that you get is this. Now, the second thing that really is confusing is that if there is a ampullary stricture, if there is an ampullary stricture, say for example, a benign stricture, and that leads to a biliary stasis, and that leads to a condition of a biliary stasis, what is then the status? Then it leads to a stone, and that stone again has everything to do with this. So that means, if you ask me very straightforward, in this situation when there is an ampullary stricture, the gallbladder is there, but if there is a narrowing of the gallbladder at this point, then what will you call this to be? This stone, will it be called as a primary stone? Well, in these two scenarios, our gastroenterology colleagues believe that these are primary stones, and they believe that taking out the stone and making the ampulla wide is an important. So whenever we talk about a primary stone due to either a parasite or due to an ampullary stenosis or a narrowing, so you are stuck on with a question. On one side, you have a bile duct that contains a stone and maybe a parasite. Okay. On another side, in this patient, you have a patient in whom the gallbladder is there, and the gallbladder is smiling at you and asking, what will happen to me? Now, this becomes a very, very, very difficult question. Because remember that these stones are easily taken out by an ERCP. ERCP guys are going to take this stone out. They are going to put in, after the stone is out, they may or may not require to put in something called as a stent. But what they have done very successfully is that they have done something called as an endoscopic sphincterotomy, okay, which makes the opening wide, and whatever is there will come out. So the question that came very importantly is, does all patients of a primary CVD stone, does all patients of a primary stone in the bile duct require a cholecystectomy? I hope I have made the question very straight. The gallbladder, you see, is smiling at you and asking you, what will happen to me? The answer is that remember that this is a very straight question to a surgeon. There is no question about keeping the gallbladder, and there are not too many studies, but whatever is the evidence, the answer is, if the patient can tolerate the operation, then please go for the laparoscopic cholecystectomy. But if the patient is unfit for the operation or has so many amount of coexistent diseases that doing a cholecystectomy was difficult, remember, you question doing a laparoscopic cholecystectomy. Maybe observation for this group is done, but remember, while you observe, keep your fingers crossed and ensure that the endoscopic sphincterotomy has been wide enough. So I hope that this is the first school. If you ask me, sir, what is your take or personal take? Well, I will never believe that single stone in the bile duct that has come did not come from the gallbladder. My emphasis is always that it comes from the gallbladder, and I will always consider that criminal is always, this is the criminal organ. So I will always consider that the gallbladder does need a removal. So this is the first part of the story about what is a primary bile duct stone. So there is a lot of confusions on a primary bile duct stones, and I hope that this is the first part of the story to make you understand what is a primary bile duct stone and what are the things to know about in a primary versus a secondary. So I hope this part is clear. Shahari's criteria is an important criteria for a postgraduate to remember, because whenever you are given particularly a theory question about a bile duct stone, these questions will always come. Remember, this part is always an important part to remember. Now, just two small words. Again, medicine is a very confusing subject. If cholecystectomy is done and then there is a timeline of 2 years and then a stone is detected, it will be called as a primary stone. However, within this time gap, there is a big doubt about two terms, something called as residual, something called as retained, and something called as recurrent. So you will get to hear these terms very commonly in your exams and in your daily life. So three terms, residual and recurrent, and this. One thing is for sure, whenever someone is mentioning the term recurrent, they are referring to a primary bile duct stone. The reason about a surgeon calling this recurrent and a primary is that it is this cause, remember, which occurred 2 years after, always think about doing a biliary enteric anastomosis so that there is no recurrence, which will be an ideal one. But usually we'll get to see that people will do an ERCP, wait for the next stone to happen. Maybe they will go for a biliary enteric anastomosis then. But one thing is for sure, that whenever you have a primary stone, please keep in mind as a surgeon, the ideal most treatment to prevent a recurrence will be a biliary enteric anastomosis. When do you call it primary? More than 2 years. Now, there is a big confusion between retained and something called residual. People are really confused about what terminology should be used, residual versus retained. People use them interchangeably, and things are again interchangeably used with residual and retained. But whatever happens in this block, as it is within 2 years of the operation, the first line therapy is always an ERCP or an endoscopic removal of the stone. If it fails, okay, then you will think about a lap or an open surgery. So this is usually what is our plan. But remember that biliary enteric is not usually an option in this, because when you did the cholecystectomy, you should have seen things very well so that you did not have these problems. So this is all about the first part of the story to remember what is a primary versus what is a secondary stone. And I hope I have made you understand this concept. Now, the next part of the story. The next part of the story is about what is the clinical manifestations and how to diagnose a CBD stone. Now, as I have said, the CBD stones clinically can be very, very grossly divided into two groups. One, with complications, and without complications. Now I say without complications because, as I have told you, if you have a patient who is waiting for a lap coli for a stone in the gallbladder, remember that in that patient about 10 to 20% are going to have a CVD stone without any problems. So they are absolutely without any symptom. Maybe a vague pain, but then you cannot distinguish that pain from a biliary colic. So until and unless you have a complication, things are really not very well seen. Complications are standard 4 complications, we know that. One is obstructive jaundice, which we discuss during the various case discussions. And the obstructive jaundice is typically, remember, very quick in onset rather than a malignancy and is progressive. But in about 30% to more, maybe, there may be a downtrend, but after the downtrend, again, there is an uptrend. And again, there is a downtrend. And this is due to the stone that gets dislodged from this point. So if you have a stone down in this point, if the stone goes up and down, you can imagine what happens to the levels of bilirubin into this. This is technically called as a waxing and deveining. And to remember, the bile duct does not have any muscle in the wall. So it only has a mucosa. And when it has a mucosa, to remember, when it has a mucosa, there is a lot of lamina propria or something in the subepithelium, which is fibrous tissue, lots of lymphatics, etc. But there is a tough serosa, which contains a lot of nerves. And the only thing that the bile duct can have is stretch. So the only thing that the bile duct can face is a stretching type of pain. So if you think over what is the pain due to a bile duct stone, is usually a vague, dull pain, particularly seen in the epigastrium. Now, okay, so this is all about what you are required to remember. Please don't say that it has a colic. It never does. There is no muscle in the bile duct. The second complication, remember, is something called cholangitis, which presents with the classic Charcot's triad, which is also not a very commonly seen, and statistics differ. But MBBS students are taught about that it is all about with an intermittent story. And the intermittent story is about increased temperature with chill and rigor, jaundice and pain. Again, statistics differ as to what is the most common one. Probably we understand this by the onset of increased temperature with rigors. So remember, cholangitis has everything to do with this. But when you have these three combined together, intermittent pain, intermittent jaundice, and all of this, this will be called as a Charcot's triad. And this is a classic cholangitis. Now, cholangitis can lead to a form of sepsis, definitely a gram-negative sepsis, which can lead to a septic shock. In the previous days, people did not know about this terminologies of septic shock, and then patients used to have an hypotension along with mental confusion. Now in the modern era or in the older terminology, we used to call this along with the Charcot's triad as a Reynolds pentad. Now to a surgeon like you, the importance of knowing a Reynolds pentad is only one. If a patient has a Reynolds, that means that go for an urgent biliary decompression. Go for an urgent biliary decompression. So this completes your description about what about an obstructive jaundice, cholangitis. Third complications can be a pancreatitis. And the fourth one are liver abscesses, which are in relation with this. So we have talked about what are the four common things. Some people have associated them to cancers as well. Not that important, but remember, this is what is important with any CBD stone. Now, after this is done, now let us talk about the diagnosis. We have not discussed Kurvor. So we have not discussed Kurvorcher's law. So let us talk about the diagnosis of a CBD stone and what is the treatment, because there are lots of confusions in this arena. What to do and what not to do. Okay. Now, whenever you talk about a diagnosis and the treatment, the American College of Gastroenterology gave, so this is one of my own publications in a textbook. So, what is important is, there has been, after a American College of Gastroenterology gave a good guideline about that, when do you expect a stone in the bile duct and when do you not expect a stone in the bile duct. Now, to make things very simple, you either have a low probability of a stone, intermediate probability, or a high probability. Now, in this group, remember that in this group, what is important is, in this group, you know, based on the various guidelines, remember that the intermediate probability is about when the patient has a history of jaundice, when the patient has a gallbladder stone with an increased alkaline phosphatase, when the patient has a dilated bile duct, okay, or USG shows a CBD stone. Now, USG shows a CBD stone has been a very debatable criteria, and some people have not kept it here. So this is a little older publication, and they kept it in this probability that the USG or the transabdominal USG showed you a CBD stone. So that means the intermediate probability landed up with history of jaundice, a dilated bile duct, and an increased alkaline phosphatase. Okay. Now, a high probability is either the patient has a history of pancreatitis, cholangitis, jaundice, or you get an USG evidence of a CBD stone. Or you get an USG evidence of a CBD stone. Now, so let us again recap the points and let us understand what is what about this part. Now, so the first part of thing is that a patient comes with a gallbladder stone, and while you are evaluating a patient with a gallbladder stone, then what are the chances that the patient has? One probability is low, another one probability is intermediate, another part probability is high. What is this intermediate category? Intermediate means either the patient has a history of jaundice, or the patient has a history of alphos that is increased. Some people have added bilirubin more than 1.2 milligram percentage should be important. A dilated bile duct, which is greater than 6 millimeter, that means 7 onwards. And some people have said that any two out of these four will be an important diagnostic criteria, and then will be making the patient into an intermediate group. A high chance will be the patient has a history, or presently the patient is jaundiced. Number two, patient has a history of a cholangitis, or the patient has a history of a biliary pancreatitis, or you have shown on the ultrasound of the whole abdomen that there is a CBD stone. So this group doesn't have any confusions. So this group doesn't have any confusions, and this is how you diagnose. So if you are asked in your viva or your theory, what is your approach? Remember that the patient comes in a pre-operative scenario. A patient comes with a pre-operative scenario in this. So when I will be talking about a bile duct stone, I tell about a bile duct stone can be diagnosed in a pre-operative scenario, per-operative scenario, post-operative scenario. pre-operative scenario, this is the story about a gallbladder stone. Now what? Now this group goes in for either a MRCP or a EUS, and after the diagnosis is done, and after a diagnosis is done, that now yes, I am confident that there is a CBD stone. Now starts the main issue. Remember that when we talked about this, we will always bring my algorithm down here. So I will again repeat what is my thought. Preoperative means that the patient has a intact gallbladder. Okay. And the patient has been referred to you. You are the surgeon. Okay, let me draw your surgical cap. And you are the surgeon. You are happy to go for a lap coli. Chacha, sir. Lap coli is her daily bread, butter, rice, whatever you call that to be. But before doing the lap coli, remember that preoperative means before doing the lap coli, you see the reports and then say that, acha, we have a patient now, the diagnosis has changed to a CBD stone. We are not discussing MRCP versus US. If you go for MRCP versus US, two sides of the same coin, more or the less, the studies will indicate that both of them have the near high specificities. US may be a little better accurate than MRCP. That's it. But US, remember, is a very difficult thing to do. Your hospital may not have an US facility, which majority of hospitals in the world do not have. MRI with MRCP on the other end is a much easier thing done across all the institutes. So if you remember this part, then that an US is a better investigation, but sometimes a difficult investigation. Now let us come to the diagnosis of a CBD stone. Now guys, at this point, I will strongly differ from the little books that we have. And what is important is what management you will do at this point now depends upon many, many factors. But what I will try to give you is a very logical algorithm for all of you, whatever center you may be working. Now, the first of all, the CBD stone, the management depends upon two gross findings. One, is ERCP available? Is the first question. Another side of the story goes, ERCP not available. Okay. Now, there is, however, a third group where ERCP is available, but what is more better available is a surgeon who does a lap CBD surgeon is available. Now see. So there are technically three groups, and I wrote the third group with a dot 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 line because third group may not be available in majority of the hospitals that you are working, even across the world. So that means the picture has changed a little, and in this picture we have now had a new entry called as a surgeon, called as a laparoscopic CBD surgeon. Okay. Now what is important is, if ERCP is available, think about what are the contraindications. Think over what are the contraindications of an ERCP. Contraindications of ERCP includes, remember, contraindications of ERCP will be an absolute, will be a relative. Now, the minute I talk about absolute and relative, the boundaries have blurred, and technically absolute doesn't have any things. Probably the only absolute has been a coagulopathy and pregnancy. But again, people have done in both, and these boundaries have blurred. You see, relative now has been, because the world of ERCP has evolved so much so that, first of all, remember that if the stone size is greater than, some people say 10, then 10 became, now see, with time, what has happened was that initially people said that more than 10, well, we cannot take out by a ERCP. Gradually then, the 10 changed to become 12. Then the 12 changed to become 15. And you will get many of the books till now who says that stones more than 15 millimeter, they will cross their fingers. But now, people challenged them, and endoscopist says that, who told you? We can take out 20. And then surgeons tell them, achha, 20, take out a stone of 40 millimeter in size. And endoscopy smilingly took out a stone of 40, 45 millimeters in size. Simple enough, that means that stone size is not the boundary. But remember that if it is a giant CBD stone, which is defined as something which is 20 millimeter or more, though some books have mentioned it 30, they are technically difficult stones, but for a trained endoscopy ERCP guy, they may take it out. Number two, remember that anatomical abnormalities, very important, like again having a pancreatic division. Redo cases. Last thing in anatomical abnormalities again, with a history of a Billroth 2, or in this era of a RYGB, it becomes an extremely challenging thing, but again, endoscopists have done that. Multiple CBD stone, again, as I have told you, are not at all any boundary now. People have removed n number of stones. But what probably is a relative contraindication is when stones are there in the hepatic ducts, and there is an associated stricture, then again, it is not that people have not removed, they have been successfully removing these stones. Impacted stones again have been successfully removed. So, but all of them will be are relative contraindications. So strictures with stones, particularly hepatolithiasis, these are the conditions which will be more of a contraindication rather than an indication for surgery. So when you are going to write a contraindication for a ERCP, well, the boundary is now, gastroenterologists have challenged us surgeons so much so that they have challenged boundaries, and now they can do more or less very, very difficult stones even. So this is all about what you are required to know for a basic knowledge. That means all depends upon the gentleman who is doing the ERCP. Always remember that. ERCP available and this. Number two, ERCP has its own set of complications. And the ERCP set of complications, believe me, are sometimes deadly. What are ERCP complications? Four. Most common one being always a pancreatitis, which incidences again vary, but on an average is about 5 to 10%, but majority of them are said to be mild. But majority means a minority are severe and patients die. The second most common is cholangitis, which are quinolones are used. Third is bleeding, particularly patients with jaundice and a coagulopathy. The fourth one is the deadliest, the rarest, but the most dangerous, is a duodenal perforation, which, remember, makes the cumulative death rate of a ERCP at least 1%. And if you think over at least 1%, remember that ERCP has a death rate of 1% is an important word. Remember that. But what is very good is that the stone clearance rate is about 90% at least, maybe more if not less. Morbidities, yes, they are, and morbidities are great, but stone clearance rate is 90%. So please remember that. So if you have an ERCP is available, then if your rates of death, etc., like this, you can go in for a ERCP. But remember, there is a man behind the ERCP who is important. Other side of the story, ERCP not available. Now, if ERCP is not available, then what are you going to do? Then probably the algorithm goes by saying that, do you have, or I will be writing it here, if ERCP is not available, then the story is very straight. We differ from the Western literature because their data and our setups are not the same. Then you have two options. Either go for an open COLI plus an open CBD. On the other side, you are a trained surgeon, you go for a lap COLI and you then do a lap CBD. You can have a third option, which I feel is not at all a good one. You can go in for a lap COLI, then refer the patient for a ERCP, which should be done early. There are multiple studies which have shown the feasibility of this. But again, remember that this probably is not a very, very good option for the patient, because mostly if you think over the cost consideration, and mostly remember that if the patient develops a complication or a failure of ERCP, then again, you need to go for a surgery. So that will make three surgeries then. Lap COLI, ERCP, fails, again a surgery. So this is the reason this option never became that popular. That chalo, let us do the lap COLI today. Then you refer the patient to ERCP. ERCP chap fails, has all the cost incurred. And then again, you have to think about a surgery. So this option did not become a very feasible option. But now there were two options. One, lap open COLI plus open CBD. And adult side of the story was to go for a lap COLI plus lap CBD. Now, what is the boundaries between them? The answer is that there is no boundaries. It all technically, believe me, depends on the surgeon. That's it. Very straightforward point. All that is depends upon the surgeon to take a call at this point. That's it. This is a very straightforward, simple truth at this point. Now, what is done is that whenever you think about an open COLI or an open CBD, what is done in this is that after the cholecystectomy is done, now again, there is a big group of surgeons like me who do not do a cholecystectomy first. I open the bile duct, take a guide, find the cystic duct, and then ligate the cystic duct. Okay, but you differ. But after the cholecystectomy, what open surgeons did was, they did something that, if you have seen this one, please remember this. Every surgeon who is doing an open CBD, kindly note this point. This is the most important thing that no one does. Is something called as a complete cockerization of the duodenum. Now, why do you do a cockerization of the duodenum? Is because of only one point. So that you could palpate the stone. Remember, stones are impacted at the lower end. And after you have palpated the stone, then the stone can be milked up. And the stone is milked up. And then after the stone is milked up, you give stay sutures in the CBO. You confirm the bile duct by an aspiration, and after you have confirmed the bile duct by an aspiration, then you give a stay suture, and after you have given the stay suture, until and unless you are planning to do a permanent thing with the bile duct, like as in Whipple's procedure, please, please, please don't make a transverse cholecystectomy. Some surgeons do that deliberately, which is something I feel should not be done. This is something that is practiced commonly. As an examinee, you are required to say this only. So please give a stay suture and do a longitudinal cholecystectomy. And after you have done a longitudinal cholecystectomy, there are multiple methods of stone removal. Which includes normal saline irrigation with a soft rubber catheter. It includes use of Fogarty catheters to pass into the bile duct. Okay. And it includes stone holding forceps to introduce into the bile duct. But remember, this is not a very good option. Fogarty catheter is a popular option to be used for this one. And after you have done that, then you need to confirm the presence of a residual stone. You need to confirm for presence of residual stone. Now, how do you confirm that there is no residual stone? The best maneuver and something that you must require for a laparoscopy is always a cholecystectomy. This is the best that you can have. Now, majority people don't have this. So what they do is that the second best is to go for repeated normal saline wash followed by balloon sweep with a Fogarty. Okay. And some people do something called as an on-table cholangiogram to see for this one, but this requires you to use a C-arm image to see what can be done. But again, can be a very difficult thing at some hospitals to procure by. So you need a C-arm. So this is all about doing a balloon sweep. Now, the third is not a very recommended thing, but still you will see many surgeons still do that, is they open the bile duct, take a very heavy metallic urethral dilator, and this heavy metallic urethral dilator, they say, is going to pass through this, and their basic idea was that when there is a stone in the bile duct, that stone is going to give the tongue clunk sound. But remember, and if it passes through the duodenum, they are so happy without their knowing that it produces an ampullary stenosis in future. So please don't unnecessarily put in the urethral dilator, which is something that is not a very good thing to do. People had an instrument called as Bakes dilator, but things are not very good with Bakes dilator also. A balloon sweep with a Fogarty is what you should be doing with this. So I told you how to know that. Now, after you have done that, now you have a bile duct that is in front of you, and the bile duct is asking you three straightforward questions. If the bile duct is open, what are you going to do with that bile duct? The first group and the conventional thought is, you are not sure of a residual stone. That means you are not very happy. Sir, stones may be there. The bile duct is less than 15 millimeter in size. Okay. Bile duct is less than 15 millimeter in size. Surgeon is not confident which is, you feel, a very strange but a very true factor. Under these circumstances, looks very old and archaic, but please give a T-tube. Please give a T-tube. And while you have given the T-tube, you may do, if you have a facility, do an on-table T-tube cholangiogram, which will tell you whether you have a stone or not. But this, believe me, is always something that you should keep in your mind. Many great surgeons have had their reputations restored because of a T-tube, believe me. So T-tube is not a very archaic thing. So please don't say that we have never seen a T-tube. Remember that if you are not sure of a residual stone, the bile duct is not dilated, the surgeon is not confident of doing a biliary enteric, please place a T-tube and come out. Second side of the story. You are sure of or confident of no stones and the bile duct is less than 15 millimeter. You have the facility for a biliary stent, which many hospitals don't. And you have the facility for an endoscopic retrieval. Then, see that I'm narrowing the criteria down. You can go in for something called as a primary closure of a CBD over a stent. That means, if this is the bile duct, this is the duodenum, then just give a stent and the stent will have its hook and you can now close the bile duct. You can now close the bile duct. If this is the incision that you have made, you can close the bile duct with these sutures. Okay, so remember that we take around 4 OPDs to close the bile duct. So this is all. The third side of the story is about a condition in which appreciate that the third side will be a condition in which see that the CBD is dilated greater than 15 millimeter. There are multiple stones where there is a questionable removal. You are not sure whether you have removed all. There appears to be a distal stricture which is benign, or as I have said always, if the stone is primary and the CBD is greater than 15, then please consider in these circumstances a biliary enteric anastomosis. Please consider in this scenario a biliary enteric anastomosis. What biliary enteric anastomosis? It can be a coledoco duodenostomy, number one, or coledoco jejunostomy, which is not a very good option, or probably the best one is, if it is so much so dilated, a Roux-en-Y hepatico jejunostomy. This probably is one among the best things that you could do. So this completes when will you do a biliary enteric anastomosis. Now in all of these scenarios, there is one small side which people will ignore. I'll just take 10 minutes and we'll do with lap CBDs and then we'll gradually end. There can be a stone that is impacted stone. There can be a patient with an impacted stone at the ampulla, which is not going to come out in your open surgery. And remember, you have opened the bile duct, And this impacted stone is stuck around here. ERCP man is on a holiday and you cannot take that stone out even after your cauterization. So what are you going to do? Remember, this calls for something called as a transduodenal sphincteroplasty, which means that if you consider the sphincter of OD and this is the ampulla, the bile duct enters it at about 2 o'clock. The pancreatic duct is known to enter it somewhere between 3 o'clock till 5 o'clock. So if you consider that the stone is at this point is impacted, you are required to make a cut. This is the clock. At this is 6 o'clock, this is 12 o'clock, this is 3 o'clock, and this is 9 o'clock. Remember that the pancreatic duct will be entering somewhat around here and you are not going to go to the pancreatic duct. So either you make a cut, in between this area, and we gradually go on cutting and clamping so much so that this area will look like a cone. These are the two margins that you have taken bites, and the whole thing becomes wide enough to take out the stone. The duodenum is opened in across the length longitudinal, but is closed transversely. So remember, this is how we deal with an impacted stone. So in an open surgery, remember, either we go for a T-tube or a primary closure or a colotoco or a biliary enteric, but rarely you get an impacted stone for that. Finally, talking a few words about lap CBD and we end when to do a lap CBD. Now lap CBDs. Definitely came later after a lap Cooley. Lap Cooley was done by Eric Muhe in 1985. Lap CBDs was initially done in 1992. So it came a little later. But again, the techniques have remained more or less the same. And lap CBD can be either a transcystic operation or a transcholecystic. Understand the principles and then we'll talk. Transcystic means that, as the name indicates, you are through the cystic duct. Introduce this in the cystic duct and the stone will be out. You need to put a dormia. Transcholecystic means just the same step as an open surgery. You are going to go for a cholecystectomy. So please remember this. Now, what are the special nuances about this? Very sorry. I'll just show you a picture to make you understand this part. Now, this is from one of the atlases in surgery that I took. Now, whenever you are doing a transcystic, remember, what is done in a transcystic is that, appreciate that this chap has something called as a catheter for a cholangiogram. So what he has is a cholangiogram catheter. What this chap has is a cholangiogram catheter. Okay? And what he is doing is that he is doing a balloon dilatation of this. He is doing a balloon dilatation. And after that, when you get to see the stone, you can introduce either a cholecystoscope, capture the stone with a dormia, or you can, under a C-arm guidance, fluoroscopic guidance, capture the stone and take it out. But if you have understood up till this point, then a very, very important word remains. When to do a transcystic approach? The first logic is that the stone size should be less than the size of the cystic duct. This is a very common sense. and stones more than 10 millimeter, well, are not removed by a transcystic. You cannot. Multiple stones, again, will be a very tough thing for a transcystic removal. Will not be very removed when you do that. The next part is, if the cystic duct is getting inserted into the left side of the CBD, you say, holy God, how can I take out the stone? So cystic duct anomalies will be a very tough one. Similarly, if you don't have a cystic duct, example being a large stone producing a meringe, okay, so that calls for a very difficult scenario. So what are the scenarios that you do not go for a transcystic? Stones more than 10, multiple stones, cystic duct anomalies, and meringe. Let alone talk about technology, but if there are small stone, less than 10, non-dilated bile duct, okay, is an ideal case for a transcystic. If you have the facilities for a transcystic removal. Some people have long series where they have had a huge success rate and their stone clearance rate approaches, they say, about 90%. So they say that that's a great thing. What is also very important is the transcystic guys, what they have done is that if they could not take out the stone, what they did is that they did put a guide wire, not a guide wire technically, they did put a stent in the bile duct. Now, what is the advantage of giving a stent? Stent is because now after the operation, they now send it to the RCP guy who, what he does is that he sees this stent and then does a sphincterotomy over this, and this is called as a rendezvous ERCP. It becomes easy for him to do that because now he is seeing the ampulla. Okay. Transcolidocal is the same as that of an open surgery. But remember that any CBDs less than 7 millimeter will ask very strong question. Open or lap, don't unnecessarily do a colidocotomy. It leads to a very high chance of a stricture formation. Less than 7 millimeter CBDs, if you are having a CBD stone, well, please think over an ERCP stone removal and then an operation. Transcolidocal less than 7 will not at all be a very good option. Transcolidocal, you can do all the steps that I have said for this. Either you can do a T-tube or a primary closure or a biliary enteric. So it all depends upon the surgical expertise. Transcolidocal can be with a T-tube. Transcolidocal can be with a biliary enteric, can be with a stent and a primary closure. Okay, right. So this completes all the stories about what are the things to be done before the operation. Now, at the time of operation, if you have detected that, then what are you going to do? At the time of a laparoscopic cholecystectomy, when will you suspect that the patient has a CBD stone? I have told you the answer that before all of this. If you have done an intraoperative cholangiogram routinely, which majority has been a very doubtful, then as I have said, you are going to get stones in 10 to 20%. When to suspect is the CBD is dilated. Okay. Or you have the CBD is dilated, then you go for an intraoperative cholangiogram. Now, in a lap coli, you cannot palpate a bile duct. Whereas in open coli, if the CBD is dilated, it is better to go for a palpation. Now, these are all old words. In this era of MRCP and US, we don't go for. If you feel there is something on palpation, it is better to do an intraoperative cholangiogram through the cystic duct. The rest of the steps will remain the same. The only problem is during a lap coli, if you feel on IOC there is a stone, what will you do then? The answer is either you go for a lap CBD, transcystic or transcolidocal, or you convert to a open CBD. There can be a third option. Yes, you can send the patient for an ERCP after the procedure. Some people have been adventurous, have called in the ERCP guy in the operation theater. Well, that is not a very helpful technique. So this is a post-operative ERCP. Last point, after a cholecystectomy, if there is someone with a T-tube and the T-tube shows you a residual stone or a retained stone, whatever word you use, then what are you going to do? Can be done by two techniques. Majority of us will prefer an ERCP technique, or it is a radiology interventional technique that can be done into this procedure. But these are again rarer events. Majority of us will go for an ERCP technique. Finally, two words to know and few things to see. Now, if you think over what is an ERCP is use of a side viewing endoscope. I could not take the picture of the side viewing endoscope, but the picture that is in front of your screens now is a example of an ampulla of Vater and the papilla, as you can see. You see that the opening is magnified 15 to 20 times, and even with that opening, it is so narrow. So see that openings are very difficult. Like the side in this picture, you get to see the arrow is showing you one of the minor ampullary orifices. So this is very important. Now this is what is the picture that I was venting.
Sir, there is no sound.
Yeah, just wait a while. I'll give him a call. Wait. Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, hello.
Oh, yes, sir. Sorry, I thought the connection problem.
Yeah. I think he's got a connectivity issue. He's coming back.
Sir, sorry. Yes.
Just wait for a minute.
Very sorry, guys. I got disconnected. Extremely sorry.
Yeah, Ramuj. Yeah, right.
Please. I'm just at the end of my talk and got disconnected.
Your camera is on.
I know that.
Yeah.
Right. So just a minute. Ah, so just a minute. Screen sharing, please.
You can share your screen, Ramanuj.
No, I cannot.
Okay, wait.
Yes, I can. I will be taking all your answers. Just give me a second. Right. So, can you see the screen now?
Yes.
Hello?
Right. Yeah, you can see your screen. Yeah.
Now, right. So, I was in the video. No. So, as you can see, this video. Now, so we were at this part of in which the sphincter atom, appreciate that, cuts it at about 12 o'clock. So many of you may not have seen an ERCP this close. So see how an ERCP is done. So the endoscopist, what he does is that he identifies the ampulla, makes a pre-cut. So they are technical terms. And it usually at 12 o'clock that he makes a cut. And see that he is making intermittent bursts at this point. And bile is coming in like this. But still bile is not coming in like a gush that it should. And now see the stones are gradually coming, and what he has done is that he has introduced a balloon and he's trying to take out all this. Now can you see the balloon in this? So this is how the bile duct inside looks like, and there is a free flow of bile. So this is how exactly what is done with a ERCP and a stone removal. So see that the balloon has been inserted, and the balloon sweep makes it possible for the endoscopist to take out the stone. So see how multiple stones are there in the bile duct. And as I've told you, it is all nothing about now. Number is not any limitation anymore, because with the skill of the endoscopist, definitely this. Now, there is a group of endoscopists or who say that this normally these balloons that you see in the picture can be dilated up to 10 millimeter. That means the diameter of the bile duct. But if there is a larger stone, people will do something called as an endoscopic papillary balloon dilatation, which uses more larger balloons of 20 millimeter or more. So for example, if you use a stone or a balloon which can be huge in size, like this one, so much so that they use a large endoscopic papillary balloon dilatation to dilate it up to about 20 millimeter and take out the stone. Now, talking of stones, if you have seen the picture, this is a picture of something called as a Dormia basket. And those of you who have not seen how a Dormia is done, this is exactly how a stone is caught in the Dormia basket, held, and then gradually pulled out. So these are the things that you are required to know in this. Okay, and now, so we have completed more or less all the parts of your ERCP to this. So now we'll be taking your questions one by one. We did a big chapter. There are many other smaller things to talk, like diagnosis, there are treatment nuances, etc. Okay. So please, I'll be having your questions one by one. I think the inbox is filled up. Right. I could not have answer all of. So please, I'll be having your questions now. Hello. Yes, questions, please.
Anyone has any questions, you can ask.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please.
Good evening, sir. Sir, my first question is the retained stone and residual stone. Is the same thing?
Retained and residual will be the same thing. The only problem is that no one exactly knows the time limit when is retained residual. Some okay. people say that less than 6 months is retained, more than 6 months is residual. Now, this is only a play in English. I could not find any difference, but both of them are less than 2 years.
Okay, sir. Second thing is that, sir, in preoperative, if IHBR is dilated, so we can take it as a high risk for the CBD.
Yes, Yes. You can. Because you can you take it as sir, an yes, absolutely. If the HBR is dilated, but you could not see a stone, that means it is to be considered in the presence of a gallbladder stone that this is a high risk. Okay.
Okay.
Sir. And you can directly proceed to an imaging, preferably. Hmm. Remember that an imaging should be a preferable one rather than doing a directly operation. But those of us who will do a lap CBD, they can do without an MRCP or US, and they can directly proceed to an intraoperative cholangiogram to take a decision.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Sir, another question is the some Fogarty catheter. It is same what we are using for the artery or some different for the
No, it is exactly the same Fogarty. The same Fogarty that you use for an artery.
Okay, sir. And the cauterization, is it must, sir?
Yes, cauterization for an open surgery is mandatory.
Mandatory.
If you are not doing cauterization, you are not doing a right job.
Okay, sir.
Because you need to palpate the bile duct. Yes.
Okay, sir. One question is that, sir. Biliary enteric anastomosis and transduodenal sphincteroplasty. Sir, you told if you are using any hard or blunt instrument to pass out the stone through the ampulla, it is chances of the future biliary stricture.
Yes.
So, is it not better to go for the biliary enteric fistula instead of going transduodenal sphincteroplasty and making a chance?
No, you do not understand the point. Now, when is a transduodenal sphincteroplasty done? You see, you do not open the duodenum every day. It is only done when there is an impacted stone at the lower end that could not come out. If you have an ERCP, the ERCP man has something called as a lithotripsy, which I did not touch with a purpose because I told you this is from basic to advanced. Because the more I say, the more you will get confused. But if there is a large stone or a giant stone, you can do something called as a lithotripsy to break that stone. But say, for example, you work in a facility where you don't have an ERCP with a lithotripsy. But there is a large stone impacted at the ampulla, plus minus pancreatitis, and you need to take that stone out. If you have opened the bile duct from above, that stone is not going to come out because it is an impacted stone. So now tell me, what is your only option left? The only option left is to open the duodenum, cut the sphincter, take out the stone, stitch the sphincter. That is called as a transduodenal sphincteroplasty.
Okay, sir.
Okay, sir. Okay.
How can we choose whether to do cholecystectomy duodenostomy or cholecystectomy duodenostomy, and what will be the physiological difference?
Now see, both of them will have its advantage and disadvantage. Cholecystectomy duodenostomy is the easiest operation done because duodenum is just lying by the side of the cholecystectomy. So this is technically a very easy operation. Side problems are complications include Sump syndrome. Now, if you are doing a Roux-en-Y cholecystectomy duodenostomy, you get advantages of the Roux-loop in that there will be no Sump syndrome, and the Roux and the loop Y will not have any effect of cholangitis. So definitely, if you ask me, sir, which one is better in terms of cholangitis and some, cholecystectomy duodenostomy is. Which one takes a longer time? Cholecystectomy duodenostomy. Which one is easier to do? Cholecystectomy duodenostomy. So this is the comparison.
Thank you, sir. Sir, second question is, what are the cutoff sizes for to say that CBD is dilated in different modalities?
Differs. But usually the cutoff size will be 6 millimeter in age less than 60. More than 60, it becomes about up till 8 millimeter. But more than 10 is always considered as dilated. Post cholecystectomy, diameter should be between 6 to 8. More than 9 or more than 10 will be considered to be dilated. Okay. Next question.
What are the missed CBD stones, sir?
Pardon, please?
Missed CBD stones.
Oh, see, again, a term in English, missed, retained, residual are all the same terms. The only problem is that people have attributed them to various timelines. Some people have said that if you just find it on a T2 cholangiogram, that will be called as a missed. which is the same as a retained, which is the same as a residual. So I could not find any strong literature evidence to support mist is equal to retained is equal to residual. So will be the same approach. You need a post of ERCP to take them out.
Okay, sir. Sir, my second doubt is, will you place a T-tube through the corridotomy site? Where will you place the T-tube, sir?
Where will you place the T-tube? Sir, I refrain from talking about a T-tube because T-tube as such, I think that we'll have a ward round one day in this biliary session on T-tubes, and then we'll be talking in details about an hour on management of T-tubes. So I think that we'll be talking about that day on, because there are many issues in management, clamp or not to clamp, when to take the T-tube out, when to do a T-tube cholangiogram, where to place a T-tube, how to make the T-tube. So there are many issues on a T-tube. So I think that we'll be having a ward round on that and we'll be talking about those issues.
Okay, sir.
Just before that, I'll tell you this person, I think the T-tube cholangiogram, a small bit of there is in the YouTube. If you go to the earlier videos, Ramanu just spoken about this. I think the 15-minute video, I think it's in that. You can check it out.
Yes. You can check that out. But again, we'll have a class on that.
We'll have a class for you.
We'll have a class on biliary leaks and this.
Sir?
Yeah.
Why ESWL is not accepted as a modality of treatment in CBD?
No, you can see. Number one, ESWL is not an acceptable modality because ESWL will produce... Number one, the stones in bile duct are soft. They are made of either cholesterol, majority of them that comes from gallbladder, or if they are primary, they are made of bacteria and mud. So ESWL needs a hard stone. Like, see, what is ESWL? ESWL is a sound wave which hits a solid surface. And say, if you sing very loudly, or if there is a loud sound, the windows and the glass breaks. So ESWL is that. But if the stone is soft and if there is a high sound, the doors which are made of wood, they do not break. So ESWL is very effective in pancreatic calculi. And if you have seen publications, a big group from Hyderabad has initially published about more than 5,000 cases of ESWL for pancreatic calculi because they are made of calcium carbonate and they are very hard. Around 80% of pancreatic calculi are radio opaque. So ESWL is effective for pancreatic calculi, but bile duct, no, they are not at all effective. So they are usually not the choice.
So ESWL always followed by a stenting, right, sir? In pancreatic calculi?
Always followed by a stenting.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Is there any more questions? Then we'll close the session. Okay, I think we'll close the session. I think let me just see the chat. Saurabh, you have asked the question, if there is a mild to moderate stricture below the CBD stone during intra-cholangiogram, then what should be done?
Below the stone, that means that, see, below the stone, there is a stricture, means that the stone has probably got impacted above the stricture, or the stone has formed because of the stricture. Now, the best option, always remember, if the bile duct is dilated more than 15 millimeter, is always to do a bypass.
Yeah.
Remember that if they do a bypass, there is a guarantee that the stone is not going to come again in the life of the patient. So that is what you are required to remember. Okay? Rudra, I just forgot to show one picture. Very important. Yeah. I really forgot to show one picture. This is a picture that I really forgot. Now, what to do if the patient has a RYGB, or what to do if the patient has a Billrox 2 done? Now, will the endoscopist not be able to take the stone out? Very difficult. So they do a procedure now. This is from the CGS publication that I took up this picture. They did do a procedure in which they use an endoscopic ultrasound-directed transgastric ERCP. That means with a little amount of gastric pouch that is remaining, this is what they use to do something called as an edge procedure, which is something that is done latest. But previously to that, they did something called as an enteroscope, which had a 200 centimeter length, which they passed retrogradely from the afferent loop and then entered the duodenum. But that was a hell of a procedure. Now, this has been another new procedure where they go through a transgastric port, and through a transgastric port, they now do the ERCP to retrieve the stone out. So one of the reasons that probably lap coli should be done along with a bariatric surgery, because if there is a residual stone after this, it becomes hell of a difficult.
Yes, and this is something which we have addressed extensively in the bariatric class that I have taken. It is also there in the YouTube. You can see the common, you know, complications that might arise.
Right.
Okay. Sir, if there is a distal structure, we don't call it as a primary sebaceous stone.